My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberto with AV Ultra, and in these lessons, we're going to be covering masks in Apple Motion. This is a three-part lesson that's going to cover the different tools and techniques I use for masks. The first lesson is going to be an introduction to masks and reveals, and we're going to be creating this title here. So we have some text coming in. You'll notice that it is being revealed from invisible places. So this text is coming in from the bottom here. This text is coming out of that other text. Lastly, we have our subtitle coming out from below it. In part two, we're going to be taking a look at sky replacements and screen replacements. Almost every time that you see a screen or a tablet or something like that in a commercial, they've all been replaced, tracked, and then new footage has been put in there. Our third and final mask lesson in this series is going to be all about rotoscoping in Apple Motion. As I mentioned, this is what we're going to be creating here. So we have some text coming in, we have this outline, and we have a lot of different elements that are pulled together to kind of create this look. I've went ahead and I've opened up my 17.1a start lesson. And what you're looking at is the basis of how I created that other title. I have a few different groups and I have a few different items. Let's go ahead and expand this just so we can read that a little bit clearer. I have a layout layer, and in that I have a bezier. I have a text group layer, and in there I have my different text elements. And all of that is combined in a title layer. And that title layer lets me freely move everything around. I have another background layer, and that is just some footage from an artist that I know named BEEPLE, Mike Winkleman, and he does some incredible 3D artwork, animation, and design. So if you're interested, be sure to check him out at BEEPLE Crap. For right now, we're just going to turn off that layer and get started with our layout. To start with, we're going to break this down into different sections. We're going to turn off our text layers and just work with our layout layer. This shape was originally created just using a square and then going to my inspector, going to my geometry and converting it to points. The reason why I did that is when you use the distort tool, things can get a little funky with masks. So for our purposes right now, you can either create a shape or we can draw this one out. Now that we have this as our base, I'm going to call this our main outline. And what I want to do is I want to cut out a section of it. And I have a couple different ways to do that. I could just go to my mask tools and use a bezier mask and cut this out. That's one way to do that. And we're just going to undo that. Or what we're going to do is just use this shape as a basis to cut out our other shape. So I'm going to go to my main outline. I'm going to hit Command D to duplicate it. And we're going to call this one cut out. And I'm just going to change this from a gradient to a solid color, and we're going to leave that solid white. And what I want to do now is I want to go to my properties, and we're just going to mess with this a little bit. I can see I have a drop shadow on there. We can turn that off, and I'm just going to scale this down. And you can see that it's a little tough. It's not totally even, and that's okay because we can just work with our points. I find that it's a little bit easier to actually work with the points than the scale sometimes. And so far, that's looking so good. What I want to do is I want to use this white shape to cut out of our main outline. If I go to my main outline and I right click this, we're going to add an image mask. And what that does is it opens up a new layer in our panel, as well as in our layer stack. And what this is saying is it's waiting to use something as a source for our mask. And if I just grab this cutout, I can either drag it right here or right into our well. And now that is using that to actually make that shape. So as an example, if I take this cutout and I pull this over, you can see what it's doing is it looks like it's erasing some of our main outline, where in reality, our main outline isn't being affected. We're really working with this. But that's not exactly what I want it to look like. I don't want this section visible. I want the outer section visible. So we're going to go to our image mask, and we're going to come to invert mask. And if I go to my invert mask and I select that, what that will do is actually give me the opposite result. So again, I can come to my cutout and I can adjust this, and you can see what it's doing. It's acting as a way to cut out that shape. By default, anytime that you use something as a mask, it will turn it off so that way it's no longer visible here, but it is still using that shape. So far, so good. The next thing I want to do is add that outline that we had in our sample project. So if I go back to our main outline, I'm going to duplicate that once more. And this time I'm going to turn off the fill and turn on the outline. It doesn't look like much because it's just in the same spot. So we're just going to take our transform tool and I'm going to drag that over here. Now there's some weirdness going on. It looks like it's being cut out in that middle section again. If you remember when we duplicated this, it actually duplicated the mask in there as well. So I can go into this image mask and just delete it. And now we have our full outline. Let's go into our outline. I'm going to turn off the drop shadow on that as well. And we're just going to kind of eyeball this a little bit. You'll notice that I have this on top of our other layer. That's not necessarily what I want. I actually want this below here. So what I'm going to do is go to my main outline. Let's first rename this to stroke. And I'm going to hit command left bracket, and that will place it one layer down in the stack. And I can see it's being affected by a drop shadow right now. We're just going to drag that over a little bit. So far, so good. So now we've got our stroke, we've got our main outline, and then we also have this cutout. So let's go ahead and turn on our text layers. And our text layers look like they're working out pretty good. Just going to turn on my transparency. And the reason why I'm turning this on is I want to point something out. If we publish this right now, our text is just going to be sitting on top of this transparency, which can work out fine in some situations, but I like to have a little bit of a black box in here or some sort of colored box, so that way the text sticks out a little bit more. So we're going to go back into our layout real quick, and I'm going to go back into our main outline. That's what we have right here. In fact, let's expand that out a little bit more. And I'm going to duplicate that once more. I'm going to open this up and we're going to invert that mask. So right now we're looking at the outside. So you can see we've got our original one and we've got this one here. And I'm going to go to that main outline. We're going to call this back plate. And I'm going to change this from a gradient to a color. And we're going to make that solid black. And we're going to take the opacity down to about 40%. Now I just want to make sure that this is underneath my stroke again. So I'm just going to hit command left bracket, place it at the bottom of our layer stack. So now I can turn on my color again, and that's going to work out pretty good. So I'm going to close up this layout for right now, and I have my text layers. Our next step is we're going to animate these different text layers. I'm going to go through this very quickly, but if you have questions or if you want to learn about how to animate text using behaviors, I have a whole lesson all about text behaviors. So you can jump into that lesson and check it out, or you can follow along here and then go check out that lesson. We're just going to work with our masks right now. So I'm just going to highlight this text and turn off these other texts. Go to our library under behaviors, and we're going to go to text sequence and arrange in. I'm going to go to the beginning of my timeline here, and I'm going to decide right around the 1 second mark. I want this to arrange in. So I'm going to take that, drag that here, open up my inspector. We're going to change some of this format. We're going to remove the rotation and we're going to take this down to about a negative 300. And we're going to go to our variance, take that down to 0. And I'm just going to work on a little bit of this spread and we're going to decelerate it. So if I play that back, there we go. You know what? Let's again trim that to about 1 second. Have it last just under a second. So our text comes in and there it is. Now I don't want it visible below here. What we want to do though is just use one of these other items that we've already made as a mask source. So we could use our backplate. So if I go to my mask text and right click it and use an image mask, I can drag this in here, but something weird happens. Our text now is a little bit more transparent. And the reason for that is because our back plate is transparent. If I change this to 100%, well, now that's working out, but our back plate is now invisible. So I don't want to do that. I want to make that 50%. So instead, we could probably use this cutout section that we originally used before as a mask source. So if I take this cutout, and I drag this into our image mask. Now if I play that back, well, that works exactly the way I expect it to. So that part's done. So I'm going to collapse our masks here. In fact, let's go ahead and lock that so we don't mess around with it a little bit more. And now I want to have my in motion. And we're going to do the same kind of animation that we did in the mask, but just coming from the top. So in fact, what I can do is I can take that mask, arrange in, copy it, paste it in motion, and instead of coming from down here, we're just going to drag it from up here, and let's drag it in our timeline. And this one, I don't want it to come in per letter. I want it to come in per word. So we're going to go into our text behavior in our layer panel. And let's go, instead of character, we're going to do word in motion. And let's turn down that spread. So for our in motion, we're going to have to add a different kind of mask. If I use this same cutout, that's going to block the whole thing. So instead, what I want to do is create a new group. We're going to call this group masks. And I'm going to go to my cutout, and we're just going to duplicate that. And I'm going to call this in motion mask. We'll drag that into our mask group. And I'm going to turn him on just so that way I can adjust these points to see where exactly I want to mask this out. So I want it to be right about there. And we can turn him off. We're going to go to our in motion, add image mask, and drag in that in motion image mask. We're going to want to turn on the invert mask. So now it's only showing up right there. We have one other issue with this, is we have our text showing up here. We don't necessarily want that. Well, an easy way to take care of that is we can go to our arrange in, and instead of 309, we could just have it at 150. And since now it's starting well within that box, we just have them revealing from there. Let's go ahead and animate this last piece, and that's our AV Ultra tutorials. Same concept, if I take this arrange in, copy it, and we'll collapse everything else just so we have a tidy way to work. Go to our text layers, AV Ultra, and paste. There's our arrange in, and we don't want this to start till about here. And for this one, I want the whole line. So I'm selecting my behavior, line, and we'll have ease both. So now we have that animating. And what we're going to need to do this time is I can't necessarily use those other masks that we've already made. So what I'm going to have to do is go into my main layout, and we're going to duplicate that one. And we're going to call this one subtitle mask. And I'm going to drag that into my masks. And I want to open that up and turn off its own mask. So we have a solid shape for this subtitle mask. And I'm going to go to my AV Ultra tutorials, right click it, image mask, and drag in that whole shape. And we're just going to invert the mask again. So what we're doing is we're using this whole shape with the inside to mask out this area. So far, so good. I'm going to zoom this out so we can see this a little bit better. If I have my entire title, in fact, let's go ahead and put our masks right in with our title. Now I can animate this whole title all at once. So what I'm going to do with this guy is we're going to take this title, we're going to go to our library, behaviors, basic motion, and move. We're going to drag that right onto our title. And we only want it to really move until this text starts animating. So we're going to take this behavior and drag it all the way back, or hit the letter O on our keyboard. I want it to go from a certain place and end up here. So if I go to my move, I can drag this here and then all the way down here. So as this animates on, we have this pop in, and let's refine that just a little bit. So instead of constant, let's decelerate it. So it comes in. The last thing I'm going to do with this is I'm just going to stylize this a little bit. And the reason why I want to stylize is because this looks okay now, but I really want it to pop a little bit. So we're going to add just a couple different things. Under my filters, I'm going to go under glow. And under glow, we have a couple different items. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to grab this light rays and just put it on the main outline. And right away, you can see it's kind of creating this effect where it's got these light rays shooting out everywhere. What I really want to do is start with that and turn it down. And I want to turn up a little bit of the glow because it's going to give me a little bit of warmth and hotness. And we're going to leave that as is. So just a before and after. Now I'm going to take my whole layout group, go under my library, back under glow, and we're going to go to glint. I'm going to put glint on my layout. And again, right away, it's way too much. So what we want to do is we want to just take this down a little bit, maybe add three streaks and really pull this back. We have some color fringing here, and you can see what that's doing with our RGB. So it's giving you a little bit of chromatic aberration. You can adjust that if you'd like. And we can also pull down this intensity because less tends to be a little bit more. I definitely want to add just a little bit more of those streaks, but we can turn down that intensity a little bit. I'm just going to animate this. So we're happy with that. I'm just going to add this exposure and this mix. Move back a little bit. take this down so it looks like it kind of pops on. In fact, we'll have it go up a little higher, just a little much, and then we'll go forward a little bit and take that down to 2 and maybe 75 for our mix. This glint might be a little much, so we might just want to add a fresh one to our text and just pull that back a little bit. As a finishing touch, I just want this to draw on this outline. So I'm going to go to my behaviors and we're going to go to a write on behavior. So I'm going to go all the way to the bottom and our write on behavior will do exactly what it sounds like. Draws or erases the outline of a shape over time. If I drag that right onto my stroke, we can go to that and we'll take it back to right about here. So now it creates just a little bit more movement as everything else is happening. Maybe drag that to here. Okay. Turning on our background to finish things off. And now we have our completed title using masks. So that's a basics of using masks in Apple Motion. Hopefully that'll show you how you can use different shapes and different items in your composition as mask sources so you can reveal certain things selectively. Again, my name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta. Thanks a lot for watching and hopefully you found this information useful.